Okay, let me go back to this. 17th, 19th. Great. Did we discuss about Bhuvan? China's permanent space station. Thanks a lot, Sneha. That was really helpful, I think. That was NFLs, Russia, Neutrino, Lake, NFT markets, Bitcoin, horizontal gene transfer, integrated. From diphtheria, China, where is China? Let's give me a moment. Let me search. Where is our loving neighbor? The neighbor that loves us. Yes, I got it. Very good. So, let me share the screen. So can you see the China topic thing, everyone? I hope it's all visible to you, except my videos. So we have today Alice, Benita, Gyanesh, Michael, Pankaj, Raj. Great. So good to see all the students. Welcome back. I hope you had a good time. I hope you missed my classes, which is not a possible case. I'm just trying to boast myself. So now let's start the topic where we start. So we were discussing about science and technology, and in that we were discussing about our loving neighbor, the beautiful neighbor, China has launched an unmanned module. What do you mean by unmanned module, right? UAV is what we, another example of unmanned, that is unmanned aerial vehicle. Things that are auto run, right? There is no manual intervention. Drone is a good example of an unmanned aerial vehicle. So what China has done is that it has launched an unmanned module for its permanent space station, which will get complete by 2022. This particular module is named as Tiangong Station. How do you pronounce this? Tiangong Station. I repeat, Tiangong Station. All right. This will be an only alternate to International Space Station. UPSC has asked one question in the past about International Space Station. And the question was, consider the following statement about International Space Station. Consider the following statements about International Space Station. And they basically ask you why it is in low orbit. And one of the reasons is that it's easier for the astronauts to go and come back, right? So that's why it is in low Earth orbit. Now, what is this particular space station, right? Tianhe will do. This will orbit Earth at an altitude of 340 to 450 kilometers. It has been launched on Long March 5B. This is China's largest carrier rocket. China's largest carrier rocket. If they are asking about China's largest carrier rocket, then we should also know about India's largest carrier rocket. Can someone tell me beautifully what is the name of India's largest carrier rocket? Quickly, what is it? GSLV, you are very close, but not close. You are close, but not completely close. There is something else addition to that. Pankaj. Yes, yes. Mark 2, Mark 3, I think. Right? Which is GSLV, RLV. GSLV, Mark 3, RLV. RLV stands for relaunch vehicle. That means the idea is that this particular spacecraft launch vehicle should launch from the Earth, go back to the space and come back to the Earth. So relaunch vehicle. Clear? GSLV Mark 3. I hope I'm clear. Now, scientists have basically from Agrakar Research Institute, Pune, in collaboration with Indian Council of Agriculture Research, has developed high yielding and pest resistant soybean. Now, what do you mean by high yielding and pest resistance? Let's do that. Okay. Let's try to understand that. When I have 1 acre of land, by putting 15 kg of seeds, if I'm getting say around 100 kg of soybean, right? By putting 15 kg, if I'm getting 100 kg, and then if I use some techniques of genetic modification, use the same 15 kg, but now the output is around 200 kg, that is what you mean by high yield variety. That is what you mean by high yield variety.
Fifth.
Got the idea? This is what you mean by HYV seeds. And pest resistance. We all know that pest attack is a very common attack in agriculture. When the pest attack agriculture crops, there is a lot of losses that farmer has to face. So that's why these scientists develop soybean, seeds, which is not only pest resistance, but also high yielding variety. It also requires 43 days of flowering, which is less than the current one. Very, very important. The variety is named as MACS1407. Tomorrow they ask you, which of the following is related to agriculture crop. Tomorrow they ask you, which of the following is related to agriculture crop. Point number one, GSLV Mark 3, true or false? GSLV Mark 3, true or false?
False.
False. H1N1, true or false?
False.
False. B1716, true or false?
False.
Exactly. MACS1407, true or false?
True.
Exactly. So, the idea was they may not be very specific about making you mugging up the word or the name, but they might ask questions from this type where you don't need to mug up, but you need to know, right? Then the other way to ask these kinds of questions is they might give you sentences. For an example, they might give you, it is a white colored flowers, yellow seeds and black helium. It has thick stem, right? Suitable for mechanical harvesting. It is a rain-fed condition. Suitable for the condition in the state of Assam, West Bengal, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Northeast. And it is also resistant to major insects. They might give you this sentence and then ask you to identify the crop. Got the idea? That is what UPSC might ask. Clear? Any doubt? No doubt. Sir, will it be the locus resistance? No. Locus is a very serious phenomenon. Pest attacks are a very small attack. Locust, when attacked, they attack in millions, right? They attack in millions. Next. Tejas. What does Tejas is related to? Can someone tell me? Tejas. Tejas aircraft. It is India's indigenous light combat aircraft. LCA. Light combat aircraft. India's indigenously made. That means locally developed. When you develop locally within our own country, then we call that as indigenous. Right? It is India's indigenous light combat aircraft, Tejas. So tomorrow they ask you, Tejas, have you heard about Bhuvan? Bhuvan? Not the Aamir Khan in the movie Lagan. I'm asking about Bhuvan. Heard about Bhuvan? Where did we study about Bhuvan? Quickly, where did we study about Bhuvan? Missile, yo, no missile. We did it Bhuvan in the first class. I even sang a song for you. Remember? Bar, bar, ha. Ha, exactly. Not navigation, sir. Very close, very close. It is a satellite, right? It is a satellite that can be used for location of water resources, mapping of terrain, portal, exactly. It's a satellite with its own portal. Great, great. No doubt, no problem. So India's light combat aircraft, Tejas, has been added with the capability of an Israeli origin Python 5 air-to-air missile. Air-to-air missile, Python 5, right? It has been developed by Israel defense company, Rafael Advanced Defense System. This is air-to-air. Got the idea? What do you mean by air? And the target is in air. When you want to fire it in the air, it is air-to-air. It is air to air. Now, what is Python 5 missile? Why is it so famous? Why are we adding it? This is not some Diwali pataka that you are adding it and it doesn't make sense. It can be launched from a very short to beyond visual range. Beyond visual in the sense you cannot see the target and still you can attack that target. Beyond visual. It is out of your eyesight. Right? And has a ability to kill with a greater probability. That means with more probability. With more probability. That means the error is less, the correctness is high. It is a dual-use missile suitable for an air-to-air and a surface-to-air mission. Air-to-air and surface-to-air mission. It is powered by solid propellant rocket engine. Solid propellant rocket engine. It is also equipped with lock on before launch and lock on after launch. That means either you fix the target and hit the missile, or you start the missile and then fix the target. But obviously you have to launch it in the same direction. In the sense, if you want to hit a target which is near Pakistan, you cannot launch a missile which is in China. Doesn't make sense, right? You can launch it in the same direction and then fix a target. What is Tejas? As I told you, someone is asking question. Sir, if you compare this missile with Iron Dome, which one will be better? Oh, full on current affairs knowledge. Iron Dome is an anti-missile system. There is no comparison between Iron Dome and Python 5. Iron Dome is an anti-missile system where you misguide the missile that are coming towards you. Python is an air-to-air missile that is fixed to the combat aircraft. Taba. Am I clear, Taba? Iron Dome is an anti-missile system. Okay. Good question. Iron Dome is an anti-missile system. It is sophisticatedly designed. Any missile that is coming towards the Israel, they can be misguided and can be neutralized in the air itself. Whereas Python 5 is an air-to-air missile. Now, light combat aircraft. Now, Tejas is a single engine, lightweight, highly agile, multi-role, supersonic. Can someone tell me what you mean by supersonic? Supersonic. More than the speed of the sound, right? When it is, there is hypersonic, there is supersonic. When it is more than Mark 5, we call that as a supersonic. So it is developed by Hindustan Aeronautical Limited, HAL. It is based in Bangalore. It's a public sector enterprise. HAL, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, designed by Aeronautical Development Agency. It's again a government agency. Exactly, Taba, you're correct. Mach number beyond 5, then it is supersonic. Between 3 to 5, hypersonic. The indigenously developed aircraft has been manufactured at Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. And is designed by Aeronautical Development Agency for Indian Air Force and Indian Navy. It is designed to carry a range of air-to-air, air-to-surface, and precision-guarded weapons. Now, quick facts. Simple, but easy. The world's largest airplane has been built by Stratolaunch. Where does the word strato come quickly? Ting, 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 ting. Quickly. Tick, 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 tick. Stratosphere. Oh, what? What a knowledge. What a knowledge. Exactly. So, the world's largest, so these are two airplanes, one, two, like this, one, two, joined together. So the world's largest airplane has been built by Stratolaunch, recently completed its second test flight from Mojave Air and Spaceport in California. It was established by Paul Allen in 2011. Right, so it's a very important current affairs. Stratolaunch, world's largest airplane. Then another small fact, very, very small but important to remember, the Ingenuity helicopter of Mars 2022 project of NASA has also recently performed its fourth of its 5 planned flights, right? That is Ingenuity helicopter, Mars 2020. another very small topic. P8I. P8I, Patrol Aircraft Sale. The United States Department recently approved the sale of P8L Patrol aircraft to India. It is a long-range patrol aircraft. It was manufactured by Boeing. It is a variant of P-18 Poseidon. This Poseidon is operated by U.S. Navy. This P-8I is capable of conducting maritime in the sense in the sea. Maritime patrol anti-submarine warfare. Clear? P8I is capable of conducting maritime patrol anti-submarine warfare. Any doubt? No doubt. Shall we move on? My dear students, if you are not sleeping, we can move on. I hope you are not sleeping. A very good afternoon. Yes. India has announced National Hydrogen Energy Mission. Can you repeat with me? National Hydrogen Energy Mission.
National Hydrogen Energy Mission.
What a response. Proud of you. May God bless you. So, India has announced National Hydrogen Energy Mission. It's a roadmap for using hydrogen as an energy source with a view to capitalize on the most abundant element on the earth, that is hydrogen. Hydrogen seems to be the future of energy. It's clean, it's green, it's beautiful. What is hydrogen? First of all, it is in abundance. It is a clean source, as burning hydrogen does not produce a harmful byproduct. It's not like oil where you get carbon dioxide or carbon monoxide. It has near zero carbon footprint. It is not a toxic source for human health. It has a very high energy density and is highly efficient. Found in abundance, clean energy, near zero carbon footprint, and it's not a toxic source for human health. Now, basics about hydrogen. Very, very important. I told you, right, that one of the most important thing that we should remember in science and technology for UPSC exam is whatever comes in current affairs, you have to study the static part of that, whichever topic it is. When I say soybean, try to find out which are the areas in India that grow soybean. So you always take current affairs, this kind of system. Got the idea? So now basics of hydrogen we will try to study, I hope. It is the lightest and the first element in periodic table. Remember periodic table? In your school chemistry book, you had a periodic table. All elements arrange in a periodic table with similar properties, mass number, atomic number. Remember? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
It is the lightest and the first element in the periodic table. The weight of the hydrogen is less than air. It raises in the atmosphere at a standard temperature and pressure. And hydrogen is non-toxic, non-metallic, odorless, tasteless, colorless, but a highly combustible gas. It burns like no doubt it is non-metallic, non-toxic, odorless, tasteless, colorless, but it is highly combustible gas. Okay, what about its occurrence? It is abundant in the universe, right? Another reason why it is abundant is also because of the fact that water is the most abundant component and hydrogen is found on the earth with the water. Okay. Most hydrogen on the earth is bonded to oxygen in water and to carbon in live or dead or a fossilized biomass, which makes this, you know, easier to extract and abundance in nature. I repeat, it is abundant because it is bonded with water. Even of the whatever is left out on the earth is bonded to carbon in live or dead or fossilized biomass. Now, the most important for your prelims, types of hydrogen. There are three types: brown, gray, green. I repeat, brown, gray, green. Brown is basically production of hydrogen from coal. It is by coal gasification method. Very, very important. Coal gasification method. Gray is the production of hydrogen from natural gas. Tomorrow they give you how is gray hydrocarbon produced from natural gas, from coal, from electrolysis, from water. Your answer should be from natural gas. The method is steam methane reforming. Globally, this is the method used for producing hydrogen predominantly. Okay. Third is green hydrogen. Green hydrogen. It is by electrolysis. Where the water is split. However, the electricity should be green, and moreover, it is very highly energy intensive. So the very common method is the grow method. So tomorrow they ask you, which of the following types of hydrogen is common in the world? Your answer will be gray hydrogen. Tomorrow they ask you another question, which of the following method is commonly used to extract hydrogen in the world? Your answer will be steam methane reforming method. Can you repeat with me? Steam methane reforming method. Got it. Sir, are they really changes color or name just because of the method of production? Oh, no, no. It's just the name Mikita, the method of production. They don't change the colors. Welcome. Now, since we are studying about compressed hydrogen, we should also study about compressed natural gas. Compressed natural gas. In short, what do you mean by compressed natural gas in short? CNG. CNG is methane stored at high pressure. CNG is compressed to less than 1% of the volume. It occupies at a standard atmospheric pressure. Hence, we can say CNG is stored at an ambient temperature with a very high pressure. Temperature is ambient, but the pressure is very, very high, highly compact. Okay. LNG. What does LNG stand for?
Liquefied petroleum gas.
Liquefied natural gas. LNG undergoes a cryogenic process where cooling is done to a temperature of around 162 degrees Celsius. Okay. Liquefied natural gas. In India's mix, that is the India's major contributor in the energy, natural gas is 6%. We want to increase by 15%, and global average is around 24%, right? So that's what we wish to do. We want to increase the natural gas. Why? Cleaner than diesel and petrol, right? Much efficient, easier to transport. LNG. Very, very important topic for this year exam. Very important. The reason is that first ever liquefied natural gas dispensing station. Just give me a second. So I've let Robin into the meeting. I don't know who is Robin. Welcome, Robin, to the class. Now, first ever liquefied natural gas dispensing station, Inox India Limited, commissioned India's first LNG dispensing station at Dahej in Gujarat. It has been commissioned at the Petronet LNG terminal. It would dispense fuel to the buses which are expected to bring the staff of Petronet LNG from the Bharuch to the Petronet terminal. So this is the first time that we have done a liquefied natural gas dispensing station. First LNG dispensing station at Dahej in Gujarat. India has been seeking to renegotiate long-term LNG purchase contract, and we are trying to do it with Qatar. Why? Because we want to bring down the prices, as the LNG also is also affordable for our current economic scenario. Clear? Very, very important. Liquefied natural gas, cryogenic, that is with low temperature. Right? Dispensing station at Dahej in Gujarat. Pack this. Barabar pack. Pen bhi hai apna. HCNG. What is HCNG? HCNG is a mixture of compressed natural gas. HCNG is a mixture of compressed natural gas and some percentage of hydrogen by energy. HCNG. Advantages: carbon monoxide emissions reduces by 17%. Hydrocarbon emissions are reduced by 15%. Enables up to 5% saving. Engines need minimum modification. It's a very ideal fuel for heavy duty vehicles and a better performance due to higher octane rating. That means it's very efficient. Now, disadvantages: cost is comparatively high because of the process involved. It's not easy to compress the gas. Globally, 98% of the hydrogen is produced using steam methane method. And although hydrogen is a clean fuel, I repeat, hydrogen is clean. But the problem is, the steam methane reforming method is a carbon intensive method. Okay. Steam methane reforming method is a carbon intensive. The whole method is a lot of pollution in terms of commercialization at a large scale is little bit difficult, not that easy. Very, very difficult. Storage and supply infrastructure is another challenge. Storage and supply infrastructure is another challenge. I repeat, tomorrow, if they give you if they give you, right? Tomorrow, if they basically give you, which are the following reason that HCNG is not getting famous, then your answer should be that it has to be first. One is that cost is high. Cost is high. No, it's more like a electrolysis method only, not helpful for us, and it's not important also. World Health Organization is in the news. WHO is in the news. Can you know why WHO is in the news? Do you know why WHO is in the news? All member state for being sovereign to China. Oh, no, no. Don't use such kind of little risky language in UPSC examination. Right? Little risky in terms of UPSC examination. Never do that. Very risky. Very, very risky. Always be, I told you in UPSC, you have to be very, very calm and composed. If you use tough languages, then will be trouble. So it is in use for multiple reasons, but let's try to understand, okay, how do we solve this issue? All member state of the United Nations may become the members of WHO. Very, very important. I repeat, may become, you know, it may become. It's not compulsory that they will become the members. May become the members of WHO, and members of other states can be accepted by simple majority. If they are not a member of UN also, they can still become the member of WHO. That has to be approved by World Health Assembly. A state becomes a member of WHO by ratifying the constitution of WHO. That means by agreeing to the constitution of WHO. By agreeing to the constitution of WHO. Secretariat is in Geneva, Switzerland. It has the authority of directing and coordinating matter related to international health. Now, what is World Health Assembly? It is a supreme decision-making body attended by delegation from all the member states. Supreme delegation body is attended by all members from all the delegation from all the member states. Main functions are the policies of the organization, the appointment of Director General, supervise financial policies, review and approve the proposed program budget. Okay, it is a supreme decision-making body attended by delegations from all the member states. The main function are to determine the policies, appoint a Director General, and supervise the financial policies. World Health Assembly is annually held in Geneva, Switzerland. There is an executive board within the WHO. There is an executive board. It is a board which implements decisions and policies of World Health Assembly. Executive board. They are the executive in nature. They're the one who take the decision and implements those decisions. They're the one who take the decision and implement those decision. They're composed of 34 technically qualified elected members for 3 years term. 34 technically qualified member elected for a 3 year term. And now it is headed by Indian Health Minister Harshvardhan. That is why it is important for you. As a member, India is heading it. It's not only about heading it, right? Since WHO has been in controversy in last 2 years in tackling in the pandemic, taking a blame on China, right? Trying to defend China, trying still not able to investigate how the virus was basically originated. So that's why it is in news, and that's why very, very important. So first of all, WHO, Geneva, all the members of UN may become, that is very, very important. May, when you say may, it's not compulsory, it's an option. When you say may, it's not compulsory, it's an option. May become the members of WHO. There is a World Health Assembly, right? And there is an executive board, which is headed by the Indian minister, Dr. Harshvardhan. Any doubt? Any doubt? Great. Funding mechanism in WHO. There are SS contribution and there are voluntary contribution. These are the amounts each of the 194 member and associate member must pay to WHO on an annual basis. These are the amount each of the 194 members and associate member must pay to WHO. They are mainly based on country's GDP. They are based on country's GDP. They are approved for every 2 years by World Health Assembly. Okay. Although these ones have declined in the recent years, as an overall percentage, for several years, around 20% of the financing comes from SS contributions. Clear? Any doubt? SS contributors. The second one is voluntary contribution. These come from member state and from other partners. In recent years, voluntary contribution have accounted to more than 3/4 of the organization funding. There are two types of voluntary contribution. One is core voluntary contribution, which is fully unconditional and flexible. However, the majority of the voluntary contribution are not core, and the authority of the WHO have declined in the recent years. See, such a big organization cannot work. Right? Any doubt? What I was telling is that such a big, you know, organization cannot work without funding. They cannot do that. It's very difficult for them. Right? It's almost impossible for them. And recently, since the coming of the Trump, there has been a sudden decline in terms of funding towards WHO, and which is actually impacting, you know, the whole health, or what we call the monitoring of the health or the viruses or the disease around the world. But there might be an interesting question. Do we actually require WHO? See, we do always require WHO. Please try to understand. We do always require WHO. Because if WHO is not there, then there are a lot of other things that WHO also does is very helpful. Eradication of old diseases that we did, polio, right? Smallpox, chickenpox. Targeting malaria in African countries, WHO does give you plan, provides you support, executes the whole solution. That's why we do require such organization, right? This idea of that we should completely scrap WHO is not a good idea, because at a global level, we always required an organization that can coordinate, between the countries. One more small topic. Biological Weapon Convention. Heard about it? This is also important because a lot of people are discussing around the controversy. Okay, was coronavirus a biological weapon? Right? There's a lot of controversy and the debates going on around the world. Okay, was coronavirus a biological weapon? Right? And this is also important because to understand what is a biological weapon, what do you mean by a biological weapon? So that's why a lot of questions were happening with respect to virus. So what is Biological Weapon Convention? Signed in 1972 and came into force in 1975. US, UK, Russia are the depositors. India ratified in 2015. That means India also agreed to follow the rules of Biological Weapon Convention. This is interesting. Why are we worried about biological weapons? See, a biological weapon may just not damage one country. There are high chances that it may damage other country as well. If you, for an example, for the sake of understanding and for the sake of, say, reference, if we consider coronavirus as a biological weapon, then definitely the leak of coronavirus has led to the more damage to the earth than anything in the last few decades. We've seen that, right? We have seen that. So, this is the first multilateral disarmament treaty to ban the production of biological weapons. It is the first multilateral disarmament treaty to ban the production of biological weapons. Purpose and the weaknesses. The whole idea to start a biological convention, weapons convention, was to ban biological weapons by prohibiting the development, production, and stockpiling of biological agents. It's legally binding. Under Biological Weapon Convention, there is a provision to request the United Nations Security Council to investigate the alleged breaches. Right? Under this convention, the United Nations can basically investigate if they feel that some country is going against the protocol and the laws and the rules of biological convention, weapons convention. There also review held every 5 years. The biggest problem is that there has been zero institutional support. It starts with funding, it starts with interest. The countries are not interested. Formal verification has not been done. Compliances are not serious. Those who don't comply cannot be punished because there is no strong mechanism to punish them, right? Right? Insufficient institution support, the absence of any formal verification protocols to monitor the compliance. I hope you're clear. Any doubts? Any doubts? No doubts? Okay. Let's move towards a few more facts important for your science and technology. Indian cotton is predominantly transgenic. What do you mean by transgenic? Genetically modified organisms, right? They are called transgenic. So use the gene of one organism, right? And put it in the genes of another organism. Yes, it's legally binding only to those nations who are ratified. This is about Biological Weapon Convention. Someone asked a question, okay, legally binding for whom? Only ratified nation? Yes, it is only legally binding for ratified nations. Now, coming back to the Indian cotton being a transgenic. Transgenic means it has specific genes from one organism which has been taken from one species, have been inserted into another species so that to enhance the properties of the species. Primarily transgenic with hybrids. Two genes from the soil bacterium has been taken, that is Bacillus thuringiensis. I repeat, Bacillus thuringiensis has been transferred into hybrid varieties. As the hybrid lose their generic stability, farmer cannot refuse them. They have to purchase them every year. Majority country have also grow open pollinated varieties rather than hybrid. One of the biggest problem with the hybrid variety is, these hybrid varieties over a period of time, they have to evolve. So they may not be able to help the farmer. And since they are produced by a certain company, the farmer becomes dependent on that company. It leads to monopolization of that particular crop or a seed, right? Since the seeds are produced by that particular company only, the farmers completely become dependent on that. Why farmers are cultivating HTBT cotton is another question. The BT stands for Bacillus thuringiensis. please mute yourself. I think someone has gone to unmute. Okay. Why farmers are cultivating wheat god? It is to reduce the cost, the de-weeding cost. Removing weeds within the cotton is a very costly thing. Not at all easy. It is to reduce the de-weeding cost because this this BT cotton has an inert capacity of not allowing the wheat to grow. I repeat, this BT cotton has a capacity that it does not allow wheat to grow. So the farmers want to save cost on this, and that's the reason. That's the reason, right? They prefer HT BT cotton. They can use glyphosate to kill the weeds. That also reduces the labor cost. Glyphosate cannot work on normal variety. It might even kill the crop, but in terms of BT cotton, it will not kill the crop, which is a very good advantage for the farmers. Got the idea? Any doubts? Any doubts? Clear. Directed energy weapons. Very interesting topic. Very, very interesting topic. Directed energy weapons. Right? What are directed energy weapons? These are high energy lasers and high energy microwaves. Have you seen that movie Star Wars or Iron Man? Right? You might have seen this. Star Wars, Iron Man, Avengers. And the Iron Man uses his laser light. So these are nothing but directed energy weapons. They are high energy lasers and high energy microwaves, seen as a critical in future tactical warfare, and they are yet to be developed by any military. Advantages of directed energy weapon: pinpoint accuracy, travel at the speed of light, low cost flexibility, can engage multiple targets, can be used endlessly because they are highly energy. The energy is produced and is thrown, you see, and minimum collateral damage. Imagine having a laser light which can kill you. Having a laser light which can cut your hand. As simple as that. Having a laser light which can cut your hand. Can you imagine that? No. That's how it is. That is what you mean by high energy weapons. Now, present status. USA, Russia, China, Germany, Israel have developed drones. And India DRDO in 2022 announced that they basically are developing a weapon that can take 100 kilowatt power. Any doubt? Any doubts? No doubt. Clear. Okay, just give me a second. Hypersonic weapons, okay? What do you mean by hypersonic weapons? Heard about hypersonic? We just did in class today. Hypersonic, can someone tell me what do you mean by hypersonic? So Mach 1 speed of the sound. If the speed of the object is less than Mach, then it is subsonic. Between 1 to 5 is supersonic, and if it's more than 5 is hypersonic. Hence, now what is the challenge? The challenge in hypersonic weapon designing is that to design a material that can withstand this heat. Because you're going at the speed of more than the speed of the sound, right? It's not that easy. You're going with the more than the speed of the sound. So it's not that easy to survive that heat. The material might melt, might lead to some challenges. Although today we reach carbon fiber, nickel, chromium, etc. Okay. What about the range of BrahMos? BrahMos is a joint venture between Russia and India. It is a hypersonic missile. Recently, it was tested up to 4,400 kilometers. And subsequently, India also joined Missile Technology Control Region, where our high-end missiles come under the radar of MCTR. Got the idea? Great. So now let me start the next topic. Can you see my screen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Great. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Great. Now, biotechnology. You might have heard about biotechnology as a topic, right? You might have been seeing about biotechnology. I've been hearing about biotechnology. And biotechnology is one of the very favorite topic of UPS. They love biotechnology. They love to ask questions on biotechnology, right? It's a very pretty famous topic of UPSC. And one of the topic that the questions have been constantly appearing again and again from this particular topic. Now, I hope we all might have seen the structure of DNA, RNA, right? Deoxyribonucleic acid, RNA ribonucleic acid. There is cytosine, guanine, adenine, uracil. Very common in our school books. Very, very common in our school books, right? Great. So let's slowly study about it one by one, the topics that are important for us. Deoxyribonucleic acid and ribonucleic acid. These are the two main types of nucleic acid. They are main types of nucleic acid responsible for storage and reading of genetic information. They store every information, what we eat, what we not eat, how do we live, how is our evolution taking place, what is my health status, how's been my life performing, my cells performing? So many of them, right? They do basically check that. So they are the two types of nucleic acid. Okay. Now, there are three types of RNA. One is messenger RNA. The other one is transfer RNA called tRNA. Very, 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 very important for this year exam. Very important. Right? Because it's continuously there in use. mRNA, tRNA, and rRNA. Now, when we talk about mRNA, what does mRNA does? What does M ribonucleic acid, that is messenger ribonucleic acid, does? As the name suggests, you see Corona, Pfizer vaccine, Covaxin, COVID shield, Novavax, a lot of these in news you have been hearing about the RNA or how this particular vaccines are going to help. So that's why it is also very important for us to understand. This mRNA copies the portion of genetic code and a process called transcription. What is transcription? It is a process of copying the genetic code. It's a process of copying the genetic code. It copies that process and transport these copies to ribosomes. Transport these copies to ribosomes. Now, what are ribosomes? Ribosomes are cellular factories. Cellular factories. They help in production of proteins. Ribosomes are cellular factories. They help in production of protein. Very, very important.
कपड़े ज्यादा है दो थैले
राइट mRNA दे कॉपी mRNA. They copy portion of genetic code with a process called transcription and transport these copies to ribosomes. And what are ribosomes? They are cellular factories that facilitate the production of protein from this code. tRNA. Now, tRNA is responsible for bringing of amino acids, basic protein building blocks, to these factories. What they do? They bring amino acid to this protein building blocks and to ribosomes. And they are also in response. They basically, when you give them a coded infection, they take a response. This process is called translation. I repeat, very, very important. Transcription, translation. And the third one is ribosomal RNA. It's a component of ribosome factory itself without which the protein production would not occur. Okay. Three types of RNA: messenger RNA, transfer RNA, ribosomal RNA. Messenger RNA copies the portion of genetic code in a process called transcription. What is transcription? It's a process of copying the genetic code. And this messenger RNA transport these copies to ribosomes. And after they're taking the message from ribosome, this tmRNA, the ribosomes produce proteins. What do they produce? Then there is transfer RNA. What does transfer and RNA does? They do transfer. And what do they transfer? They transfer amino acids. What do they transfer? Amino acids. And these protein building process is called translation. And the third one is ribosomal RNA. Ribosomal RNA. Ribosomal RNA. Now, ribosomal RNA is a component of ribosome factory itself without which the production of protein would not occur. Without which the production of protein would not occur.
Okay.
It's a component of ribosome factor itself, without which the protein production would not occur. I hope I'm clear. Now, the difference between this RNA and DNA is UPSC favorite. They have asked the question in the past. Although it looks simple, but let's study. RNA converts the genetic information contained within the DNA in a format to be used to build proteins and then move it to the ribosomal protein. You already saw that, right? DNA just replicates the genetic information. RNA has one strand, DNA consists of two strands. Very common difference, we all know about it. We have studied in the school. RNA shares adenine, guanine, cytosine. DNA, adenine, thymine, guanine. RNA is formed in nucleolus. DNA is found in nucleus. Nucleolus, nucleus. RNA is more resistant to damage from UV light, whereas DNA easily get damaged from UV light, that is ultraviolet radiation. Any doubts? Any doubts?
No doubts, sir.
Great. What is this mRNA vaccine? It's there in the news. So it's also important for us. mRNA vaccines. Unlike a normal vaccine, these RNA vaccine, they work by introducing a messenger RNA. Remember messenger RNA? We just saw transcription and all the details. Unlike a normal vaccine, RNA works on introducing mRNA, which is a coded for a very specific antigen. It's like I'm giving a code word. It's like I'm giving a code word, right? Once produced in the body, that means they first come to our body, they will tell our body, okay, look, boss, this particular virus is going to attack you. Please produce antigen. First, the body produces antigen. And this antigen is then recognized by the body. This antigen is then recognized by the body. Once produced within the body, the antigen is recognized by the body. And once the body recognizes the antigen, the body will get to know, oh, this is my enemy. And the body will start knowing to get to know the enemy. It's like they act like jasus. They'll come and tell, sir, there is a big villain coming. We have to fight with that villain. Got the idea? Once this thing happened, the mRNA vaccine teaches our cell how to make a protein that triggers an immune response inside our body. mRNA vaccine teaches our cells how to make a protein, that can trigger a immune response. See, for now, your antigens are ready. The body has recognized the antigen. So to fight with this antigen, which is an enemy, we required the soldiers of our body, which are called antibodies. They're like, aha, this is the enemy. Let's prepare for war, right? These antibodies is what that will protect our body in case this is a dhamma. This is a Duma. When the actual virus come, right, which is nothing but a copy paste of this, our body will be ready to attack. Got the idea? Our body will be ready to attack. mRNA vaccines can be delivered using the number of methods. Can do needle syringe, injection, needle free into the skin, injection into the blood, or anything. Got the idea? Any doubts? Any doubts? Clear. Sir, general question, is there a possible a genetic disorder can be corrected? Yes, we have recently done it. Genetic disorder, we have done it. Don't worry about it. We definitely have done it. Three-parent baby, what happened in US, we did it. The genetic disorder was something that we did it. So it's not a very big deal. It can be done, right? There is my three-parent baby that they did it in UK. Kamil Rang, Kal Subha. Now, what is the difference between conventional vaccine and gene-based vaccines? Conventional vaccine and gene-based vaccine. Conventional vaccine. This includes live attenuated vaccine and inactivated pathogen. They're also known as kill vaccine. Conventional vaccine, they exposes the body to the proteins made by the virus or the bacteria, and they are made by using weakened or inactivated version of the either virus or bacteria only. A weak virus or bacteria is given to the body to generate an immune response. Gene-based vaccine, they contain two types of vaccine, DNA and RNA. Instead of injecting the weakened form of virus or bacteria into the body, the DNA and RNA vaccine uses a part of the virus' own genes to stimulate the immune response rather than injecting the virus. Yeah. These vaccines, they use the genetic code of the virus, which they have it. Then they give this instruction to the host to make antigens. Both RNA and DNA vaccines deliver the message to the cell. They are like, they, rather than weak, they just give the message. They are like, sir, danger is coming. Please do something about it. They can be stored at room temperature and are more stable, and they are less risky as compared to conventional vaccine. Because even in conventional gases, one in millions, you know, chances there are there that you might get actually the virus, not because of the virus, but because of the vaccine. But right now what you're taking in terms of corona, it is gene-based vaccines, right? You cannot get corona from the GM crops. Heard about GM crops?
Yes.
Great. Genetically modified crops. Let's study what is there in the news about GM crops. Mandatory no genetically modified certificate for food imports. As per an order of Food Security Safety Standard Authority of India, that it FSSAI, from January 1, 2021, importers of 24 identified food products will have to mandatorily declare that the products are not genetically modified. This is very, very important. Importers of 24 identified food products will have to mandatorily declare that the products are not genetically modified. These includes apple, eggplant, maize, wheat, pineapple, papaya, plum, potato, rice, soya bean, sugar beet, sugar cane, tomato, etc. GM food imports required approval under two laws. One is Environment Protection Act 1986 and Food Safety Standard Act 2006. After GAC approval, FSSAI does the risk of assessment before clearing that for consumption. Recently, GAC GEAC has given a green light for biosafety research of Event 142. This is nothing but a new genetically modified variant of BT brinjal. So we studied MACS, we studied about event 142, right? And there are two more, RHT14 and RHT18, very, very important. UPSC does ask the gene names, don't underestimate it. RHT14 and RHT18. Okay, so now these are two alternated dwarfing genes in wheat. These are two alternative dwarfing genes in wheat. They are associated with better seedling vigor and longer cleopatyls, that is the sheath protecting the younger tips. Wheat lines with these genes can reduce the crop residue burning. Where is the very famous topic about cross residue burning? You have heard about it. Can someone quickly tell? Crop residue burning. Stubble burning, exactly, beautiful. Wheat lines with these genes can reduce the crop residue burning, in turn helping the climate also, because that's a very big problem. There is a very big advantage of residual moisture in the soil even under the dry moments, and that's one of the reason they have developed this particular molecular gene. Okay. Any doubt? Clear. What are GM crops? Let's quickly study, right? When you look at about GM crops, a GM crop has a gene artificially inserted into from another species to give it to some desired properties like pest resistance, herbicide, tolerant, and drought resistance. Right, there are specific genes taken from each of the organizations which would be helpful for that particular crop, and then they are inserted into that particular crop. Currently, the only GM crop permitted for cultivation in India is BT cotton. But cultivation of illegal GM crops like brinjal, soybean has been reported across multiple states. There is a well-established regulatory framework for the approval of GM crops as per the rules for the manufacture, import, export, storage, hazardous or microorganism. Very, very important. Very, very important. Why? Because any mistake in genetically modified crop might lead to a disaster. That's why the rules are very, very strict. It might kill the local species, might completely wipe out the indigenous species. We may not be able to control it. Look at the case of Congress grass, Nilgiri trees, right? You see how invasive species they have become. Okay. That's why the rules are very, very serious. A lot of concerns are also there regarding the GM crops from human health. Right? GM crops for human health, like allergic reaction, because we are genetically modifying it, it might lead to allergic reaction. Yes or no? Yes or no, sir? Yes, it will lead. Why? Why it won't leave, you tell me. environmental, like introduction of engineer Jeet into the population. What if the modified completely kills the population? GC is the apex body that allows for commercial release of GM crops. Without GAC, you cannot release any commercial genetically modified crops. That's also very, very important. What is GAC? So many times we have been studying about genetically engineered appraisal committee. GAC established under Ministry of Environmental, Forest and Climate Change. It is an apex body for the approval of activity, including large-scale use of hazardous microorganisms, recombinants and research and industrial process. The GAC is also responsible for approval of proposal relating to the release of genetically engineered organisms and products into the environment. I repeat, it's under Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, involving large-scale use of hazardous microorganisms and recombinants. The GAC is also responsible for approval of proposal relating to the release of genetically engineered organisms. Clear? Any doubt? Any doubt? Great. Okay, so that's it for today. Tomorrow we will again start from wherever we have stopped. If there's any doubt, you can definitely ask.
Thank you, sir.